Hello, everybody, dear Chairman, dear colleagues. We have been speaking today a lot about factors, hazardous factors to our health that comes from the outside. Finland, I think, is the country where we have the purest air. It is very safe outside, but we have problems when persons go inside the building. So I'm going to speak about dampness and mold hypersensitivity syndrome. If you look from the PubMed or Google, you will not find this wording. We have started to use this definition for this disease. And now I want to explain you why we liked this wording. First of all, when we stress that it is caused by dampness, we don't mean that it is our indoor air is damp. On the contrary, it's very dry inside the Finnish homes because of the heating. But dampness comes from leakage of water from the roof or from the tubings, and that creates environment for microbiota. When we say mold, I mean here it's a dampness microbiota, not only molds, because gram-positive bacteria, gram-negative bacteria, they are also very important to cause this disease. Hypersensitivity, it's certainly not allergy. Allergy has very small portion in this syndrome. I can tell you later what is the hypersensitivity that people can develop. And I want to use the word syndrome because it's a multi-organ disease. So, my conflict of interest. You see the mushroom here. That mushroom was seen near a proxy to my office where I worked in Mikkeli's Central Hospital, where I got this disease myself. That made me interested in this disease. So my topic and my speech is very emotional because I know I have gone through all these stages. I know exactly what this disease means. And when I got this disease in 2014, I studied because I could not work anymore in bacteriology. And all day long I have been studying literature and writing. So today I want to present you my own, my personal point of view. What is this disease? Not the opinion of the officials. This disease has a very big impact on person and on a society. First of all, it is a neglected disease. Although it is an emerging disease, we have a lot of cases. Almost every day we have a publication in daily papers, in media, how people get this disease at school, even kindergarten, in the hospitals, in the police station, almost every day. This disease leads to, can lead to complete disability. I know very many patients, I have contacts through Facebook, and people explain me that they want to share with me what happened to them. It's a personal catastrophe. This disease can impair people's quality of life, decrease their competitiveness and their survival. It can lead to poverty, marginalization, higher morbidity and mortality, and even suicides. This is true because the society does not support the patients who get this disease. They have no income. And this is very expensive to the society. It's not just remediation of the buildings. This is very small society should put into this problem. When we lose lives, when we lose young persons who were educated but cannot go to work, I think this is the biggest loss to the society. There is no social security in this country, imagine. In Norway, Germany, Luxembourg, there is ICD-10 codes that guarantee social security. But in Finland, we have this ICD-10 code R68.81, that means continuous or exceptional hypersensitivity to environmental common factors. The word exceptional, I don't like it, because it is emotionally charged nihilistic meaning of being idiopathic or inborn. But I claim that it is acquired hypersensitivity, and I would like to assure you in a very short time. So when, oh, thank you. When I could not work anymore in bacteriology, as I told you, I have a lot of contacts from patients and medical doctors. One family contacted me and told what happened to them when they moved to a new, brand new house, a big family with 7 children, 2 adults, and a lot of pets. And the mother was so smart, she documented everything, all symptoms, all their visits to the doctor, and I used her material, and she asked me, can you please publish it? And almost simultaneously, my colleague from Western Finland contacted me, and he said, I have very interesting material. I collected myself during 20 years. He was the occupational doctor to one school, to the teachers, and he had the statistics about mortality and morbidity in this hospital. So we made this publication, and I want to show you some facts to share with you how important this disease is. And the journal Frontiers in Immunology, the editorial board contacted me and asked whether I can suggest a research topic. And I thought we could probably touch this dampness and mold hypersensitivity disorder or syndrome, because there is no such a comprehensive publication about this. And then we started to do this research topic. And then this paper is coming very soon. Professor Ville Valtonen, he is infectionist. Unfortunately, he could not attend this meeting, but he treated almost 1,000 patients in this country. And what I'm going to present here, this is completely based on his vision. We have discussed a lot. So this paper is coming soon. Another interesting paper from another colleague, Taija Sompi, she works in Tampere, and she published, this paper is also coming, she wants to publish her results, how she treated patients with 3 iodotyronine, 9 women who were exposed to molds, and they, these women, they get hypothyroidism, but it's not primary hypothyroidism, it's non-thyroid illness syndrome. It's also a very interesting paper. So, what is the definition of this syndrome? It is a severe chronic disease with a great variability of clinical presentations and a multi-organ involvement. It is a progressive disease. if the contact with the insulting agent will continue or exposure to environmental dampness microbiota is cumulative. This is very important because when a small child goes to school and get the first contact with indoor air dampness microbiota, he gets sensitized. And then when he goes to occupation, to higher grade school, to the university, we have these indoor air problems in many public buildings. Their condition can get worse. I know personally the persons who suffered from this cumulative exposure. The disease has clinical criteria recently published by Professor Ville Valtonen. So, you know, medicine, it's a descriptive science, first of all. We don't have any single laboratory test to show who is sick, who is not. We have a variety of different laboratory tests that could be combined, but we don't have no single test. Therefore, the disease as for the clinician should be done using the interview, anamnesis, as we say in medicine. So when a doctor encounters a patient who suffers from this disorder, the patient tells that there was a history of water damage. The patient doesn't need to show the report that there is a microbiological confirmation of this leakage. It's important that the patient can recall that there was a damage because the patient has a problem now. The report can come after several months or half a year. Then, another important feature, sick building syndrome. And I will tell you in a few minutes what does it mean. It is very common to have susceptibility to conventional infections, bronchitis, sinusitis. When a healthy person starts to have so many infections, for example, 3 sinusitis during 1 year, the doctor should think, could it be that there is indoor air problems and the person is contacting toxic molds? And then, very important observation, that almost half of these persons, they will develop multiple chemical sensitivity. Professor Ville Valtonen is the first who described this through his clinical practice. He found, indeed, these clinical entities, they are linked, and I can show you how can it be, why does it come. And about 20% of these persons will develop hypersensitivity to electromagnetic field. They cannot use computers. They are isolated from the society. They have very terrible life. And even worse, some will develop light sensitivity. They have to live in dark environment. They are so sensitive. And the fifth criteria is enhanced sense sensitivity. For example, the person who has been sensitized, when another comes close and his or her dress has a smell of mold, the other will smell very exactly and does not want to have this smell. He has to go away from this smell. And the people become so sensitive, they cannot tolerate even the smell coming from the hair or from the clothes. This is an example of sick building syndrome. As I said, I have very many contacts with patients and they send me their stories, their photographs and so on. Young girl, she was sensitized at school to moles. And she was visiting obstetric hospital in Helsinki that is now closed, that is now accepted that it was contaminated with the indoor molds. And when the first picture, when she entered this building, she had exanthema on her cheek. After 1 hour, she started to react to the indoor air in this building. She had also cough, the voice disappeared, but this is very visible. This is not allergy. The second contact with this hospital, she was staying in this hospital. And again, she has this exanthema on her cheeks and here on her neck. And she had to wear this woolen cap because she asked to open the window. She cannot stay in the hospital. And when she was given some oxygen here, you see there was not so much exanthema on her cheek. So it is fresh air. There is nothing to do with allergy. And her third visit, again, she had exanthema. So that means sick building syndrome. When a person enters the building, which is contaminated with molds, she starts to react, and this reaction can happen in many different ways. So it's not the building that is sick, but the person is sick, but the building is problematic. I draw this curve. I think there is the natural cause of the disease goes like that. So first, here we have the person is healthy. There is no symptoms here. Then we have exposure, and then we have a kind of prodromatic period. Prodrome, we use this terminology from infection diseases. It's a kind of unclear stage. We don't feel very healthy, but we don't sick enough. We don't seek, we don't go to the doctor. But then the symptoms will increase. Then the person realizes he is sick. He attends, goes to the doctor. And if in that stage we know that we have problems from indoor air, we start to avoid. And then the symptoms can gradually disappear. So here they can come faster, and here the recovery can take longer time. And then if we are smart, and if our doctor is smart enough, we will avoid new contacts. But here we come to the situation where we feel like being healthy again, but we are primed. And if we have a new encounter with this indoor air molds, then we have full blown up of the disease. We have very many symptoms. It can go much worse. We can reach a disability. And the recovery from this can take a long time. It could be very improbable even. And here I put two lines because it very much depends upon very many different factors. And here, it's a graph from the family, which I have been telling you about, which moved to a new building. And the mother of these children, she documented all their symptoms. These are listed here. But what it is important to see from this graph, here the year when they moved to the new building, here the year when they have to move away, it was their own apartment. They started to rent a new apartment, and the different colors, it's different persons, and here you see their ages and so on. But here you see the trend. the longer they stay in this problematic house, the more health problems they had. Also, the mother was very smart. She found that her children started to develop multiple chemical sensitivity. Imagine when a small child attends the mall and goes to the department, toy department. Small children, they are so eager to go there, to play with new toys, to touch. But her children, they avoided this. And she made her own arbitrary scale. And here is, you see how their multiple chemical sensitivity developed. This is cumulative scale of all the members. And when they moved to another house, these symptoms started to degrade slowly. Now about the second cohort from a small school. My colleague was an occupational doctor, so he knew exactly all the records of all the teachers and of all the students. So this disorder is linked to autoimmune diseases. The observation period, as I told you, was 20 years, and there were about from 30 to 50 students, and from 20 to 25 teachers. And the average stay in this problematic house was 12 years. So there were two rare autoimmune diseases, inclusion body myositis and neurosarcoidosis. They are so rare. They can occur in one in about 500,000 cases. But there were two in that small population. Almost one-third of the teachers, they developed hyperthyroidism and very prevalent autoimmune disorders were in this school. A lot of cancers. It's very difficult to prove that there is a causality, but there were two lymphoma students, they died, three breast cancer died. If you calculate against the prevalence of breast cancer in Finland, there was six-fold increase of breast cancer. One lung cancer in non-smoker, 60-year woman teacher died. And my colleague with whom we discussed, who works in the Kruunohaka Medical Center, he described also cases, young women like me have lung cancer, non-smokers. It's so common. Teacher, you have to be careful to use, to do this observation and really to see that there is a link between exposure to mycotoxins and different kind of diseases. Also, infections. One student died from pneumonia, one teacher died from sepsis. Very unusual for Finland. And as I told you, first comes dampness and mold, hypersensitivity syndrome, and then multiple chemical syndrome, and then electromagnetic hypersensitivity. So how do these things are linked together? They are linked through a receptor, transient receptor potential, or they call it a vanilloid receptor. These are in the end, in the sea fevers, for example, the Nerus trigeminus that innervates our face and upper airways. And These receptors are ubiquitous. They are in different tissues, and they react to multiple stimuli, to temperature, to pressure, to chemicals, and also to oxidative stress reaction. Dampness and mold hypersensitivity disorder is oxidative stress reaction. It's not allergy. And here I picked a picture from Google just to show you what is the receptor. Oops, sorry. Yeah. It's transmembrane receptor, TRPA1 and TRPV2. They are interconnected, and here you see that it reacts, it can be activated through very many different impulses. Some physiological concepts. It has been published that Staphylococcus sartarum, black mold, they can produce terpenoids, aldehydes, and microbial volatile organic compounds, and they can stimulate TRPV1 receptors. So now we understand how from molds we come to multiple chemical sensitivity. And here you see what happens when there is oxidative stress reaction. There are a lot of different radicals. They all activate these receptors. And oxidative stress reaction maintain the activation of the receptors, and then we have the vicious circle. Mycotoxins, they have many different functions. They can change the polarization of mitochondria, our energy factories in the cell. They can produce new ion channels, so we can call it a ion channel disease. And when we don't have enough ATP, our mitochondria does not work, so we understand why we have chronic fatigue syndrome. That is very common for this disorder. Mycotoxins can lead to cell apoptosis, can impair functions of natural killer cells, dendrite cells. Now we understand why we have impaired immunity. We have susceptibility to infection and even cancer. Our immune system does not work. Should I stop? Okay. Here, I want to show, we have a lot of knowledge. Professor Mirja Salkinoja-Salonen published just a new paper about mycotoxin. Here you see the results from her study. She can study this, how mycotoxins affect mammalian cells. Another picture from her study, this is a list of many toxins and many species that can be found in indoor air environment. This is a busy picture. I don't want to go very in detail, but the major thing here is chronic inflammatory reaction. The treatment principle, we don't have time, it's such a big topic, but the major message here, we should stop exposure and avoid new exposure, and we should reconstruct the body, we should detoxify, we should prevent and interrupt oxidative stress reaction. And here, the conclusions, what we should not do. We don't have time now to go in detail through this. So I would like to stop here, and I want to thank Elias Hakalehto, who invited me, who gave me this opportunity to speak about this disorder. And I want to thank Ville Valtonen, who is my teacher, who is my private doctor, and with whom I discussed all these topics. I also want to thank Dr. Carlo Jaakola. He is also my private doctor, and with him I discussed a lot questions about oxidative stress reaction, and very, very many colleagues and patients from non-governmental organizations. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this impressive talk. There are questions.
Yeah, okay. I raise my voice. How come that it's not more common? I asked this question many years ago when I just came back from my postdoc. How come that we don't have more spores? How come that we don't have more spores in the air and it's not more common? Because the cases are, let's say, individual to the case, you know, immunocompatibility and everything is the one. But the spores, bloody fungi, they should be everywhere. And since I'm asking myself, how come that they are not so common? We don't see in the hospitals so many cases. It's a difficult question.
It's really a very good question. I appreciate. But I try to explain in a very short time that disease is not caused so much by spores. It is caused by toxins. Okay? And there was a very big study, a HITER study, that comprised more than 10 publications. They studied the indoor air at schools in Holland, in Spain, and in Finland. What they have found, less molds were in Finnish schools, but children were more ill. How can that be? That the answer is that those molds that grew in Finnish schools, they were more toxic. They produced more toxins. They were fewer in numbers. But the species that were grown in Finnish schools, they produced more toxins. And there is explanation why that happened.
More productive.
They use a lot of biocides. When they clean the floor, they don't clean again with water. They leave all this on the floor. And then when they have mechanical ventilation, all this comes to the air where children breathe. So spores is only one aspect of the thing, but the biggest aspect are mycotoxins. So the species that create the disease, they have mycotoxins. It's toxicosis.
Next one. Thank you, Tamara, for this excellent talk. And so I want to answer to your question what I know about it, because I think that, as you say, that it's the leakages which cause the dampness, but we have detected that maybe the worst cause of the dampness is the use of modern materials which do not ventilate. Because we had the energy crisis in the 70s, we started to build very efficiently and saving energy, but it caused the problem of the houses not being aired enough. And so, actually, Professor Hänninen asked me, why on earth we do have this mold problem nowadays, since the molds have always existed. And in the old time, farmhouses, there were lots of molds. And so I tried to respond to your question. The idea was that in these old time houses, the molds, they came and they went away. And so there was continuous variation, not constant exposure of a specific mold. And that has been caused by the methods we built the houses. And that's maybe an answer also to your question, because the mold is not on the surface. So it's not necessarily producing the conidios or other spores so much, but it's inside the walls. And we have done a lot of studies in different so-called sick buildings, and in these houses, the walls can be fully grown with different microbes, not only molds, but also by bacteria, and they can be under the paint even. It's not the news that they are confined these from there. And thanks for the compliment, first of all. And I would like now to highlight in our audience Dr. Carlo Jaakkola, who has come here to honor this occasion. Please, Carlo, step up. Sorry to bother you, but I just want to introduce you to a pioneer of the antioxidant therapy. Carlo has been working on these matters since the 80s, and he has treated more than 30,000 patients, and for good he has cured hundreds of patients which have not been otherwise treated by any means. And so his record is really impressive, and he has, most of all, he has brought the kind of analysis laboratory aside by the clinical treatment. So he's all the time, his treatments are based on scientific knowledge. So please, should we give some applause? Thank you very much. There was another question over here.
Yes. Here, next one, I think. So it's here. We should then, I hope you have also short questions, short answers, so that we will get our lunch also.
No, thank you very much for this impressive talk. It's a very emerging topic that we discovered. So you ended up by saying reducing exposure and things like that. So some answers started to go out. But I would like to hear more. Are there some studies now looking at the exposure side, be it in Finland or in Europe, the exposure, the exposition, the range of the exposition? Studies in the area of exposition.
What kind of exposition to?
Yes. The risk factor.
The risk factor.
Emphasizing on exposure to mold, to toxins.
The risk factors.
Are there some studies looking at this exposure, the exposure area?
You raised a very big question, difficult to answer in a few minutes. I think my view is, it's not so much our genetics that we are prone to have this disease or not. Maybe our genetics can influence whether we are going to develop autoimmune outcomes from this disorder. But since it is caused by toxins, everybody can get this disease. I don't think that here we have several risks. It is very much dependent if you have been exposed during your childhood or not. It is very much depends on how long you are staying in this building. It is dependent on your nutritional status, how much you exercise, how much you go outside walking. It is very individual, but I think the development of autoimmune disorders, these are linked to our HLA antigen. Did I answer your question?
It's good. You already have good answer.
Okay. We still have time for two short questions and two short answers.
Okay, this is just a small comment about the dilemma of this toxicity of mycotoxins and findings from the indoor air environment. So Professor Mirja Salkinoja-Salonen from Finland, she has a long career and she has been studying this for ages, and she has recently shown how if you isolate these kind of molds from the wall, the growth does not contain that much toxins as the spit of the growth. So the microbes or these molds, they spit, and the spit you can collect, let's say, with a cold metal plate from the air. When you insert a metal plate, which is put into cold to minus 80 degrees, and then you collect the water from the top of the plate, you can find that this liquid is 1,000 times more, contains 1,000 times more mycotoxin than the isolate of the growth. So this makes that there can be even one single strain like Penicillium expansum living in a house, and you can't find it, you don't detect it. So this is one of the questions of this dilemma.
Okay, one final question was back there, yes, please.
So thank you very much for this very interesting talk. More comment and a question. If you go to the doctors, if you don't feel well, if you're just tired, what will you get? You will get some standard treatments. I've been sick quite some times, probably I even have this disease, so I will take very much care. No one ever asked me, what about my house? Are there fungi? Is there a probability? So if your disease gets worse, you will be treated for all kinds of stuff, all kinds of names, but no one will really treat the symptoms, because no one ever asked me for that. So I think that is the reason why it's an adaptive disease, because it's just ignored that there are reasons that have to be treated, and not just what your sickness is, because you will not get healthy from treating something that is different from what you have. Thank you.
You are right. It is ignored for very many reasons. I'm sorry. We can discuss it later on. First of all, there is litigation, legal problems. If you can prove that your disease is caused in your workplace by indoor molds, you have to be compensated. But here, nobody will compensate you for the loss of your health, of your speciality, of your profession, of your job. This is one thing. Another thing, how the doctors are educated. You have to educate the doctors to know that this disease can be the cause of your symptoms. I am a medical doctor. I worked in the hospital, and when I got this disease, I was amazed. I thought, maybe I have HIV, maybe I have combined variable immunodeficiency. I could not understand what happens to me. I was all the time sick. I asked from the infectionist, from the pulmonologist, nobody really knew why I was so sick until they found this mushroom. So there are a lot of questions and answers why this disease is neglected. We can discuss, we can put a long list.
Yeah, thank you very much once more.